Thank you very much for the invitation. It's great to be here at the Technion. I think I'm maybe one of the reasons that the title of the workshop is mostly. I'm actually not going to talk about mixing times at all. So my plan is to do the following. I think I'm going to talk lecture. My lecture plan is the following. So today and tomorrow, so on Monday and Tuesday, I'm going to talk about partitions of state spaces or of graphs using eigenvectors. And there will be a connection to Chigger inequality. This is where I'm going to start today. But the motivation is not going to be about mixing time. So that's the plan for today. And the plan for, especially today is going to be all known stuff. In particular, it means that all the people in the audience who are experts are encouraged to go home. Really. So, you know, you are encouraged to go home because I'm not going to say anything new. So, you know, it's, of course, there's some chance you'll find some mistakes. So, you know, you are welcome to stay, but you're not going to learn anything new. Tomorrow, there's going to be more newer stuff and more open problems. So I think it might be of more interest to experts, too. And what I'm going to talk about on Wednesday and Thursday is going to be a similar structure. So the plan is to do the following. I'm going to talk about heating big sets.
Elchanan, we have to do a shift to the left by one on the days of the week.
Thursday and Friday?
No, Sunday.
Today is Sunday.
Yes, very good. Sunday and Monday. But this is still Wednesday and Thursday? I think that's correct.
Yeah, that is correct.
Okay, Sunday and Monday. And then Wednesday and Thursday, I'm going to talk about heating of big sets. So what we'll be interested in is related to Markov chains. We'll be interested in problems of the form. What's the probability that if you have a Markov chain, x1 is in a1, x2 is in a2, and so on and so forth, finding upper and lower bounds. But the difference from the setup of Markov chain would be that we are going to assume that we start at stationarity. There's not going to be a supremum over all the places that we start. So this is starting at stationarity. And the structure is going to be similar. I think at the first lecture, I'm going to talk about more known stuff. And at the second lecture, I'm going to talk about newer stuff and open problems. So the other thing that I did is I heard a good joke at lunch, which the goal of the joke is to encourage you to participate. This is the last lecture of the day. You're all very tired. Already kicked out the experts, some of the experts out of the room. The other experts are encouraged to go out as well. But the joke that I had is the following. It says that an agnostic, dyslectic, insomniac person is awake in the middle of the night, and he wonders, keeps wondering all night long, is there a dog or is there not a dog? Right? So I'm a little dyslectic. We're all a little tired. You know, I hope that you're going to get something out of this talk that is a little bit more than this nonsense question. Right? So please participate. I'm going to ask you questions. Please reply, and you know, let's do it in interactive. We're good? Okay, so let's start by a raise of hands. How many of you have seen Chigger's inequality for Markov chains? How many of you have not seen it? How many of you know how to prove it? Okay, very good. You want to do my job and go to the board? No, I won't ask you to prove it. For us, a motivation for what we're going to talk about, I'm going to talk about Chigger inequality for Markov chains. So that's going to be the beginning point. Chigger's inequality for Markov chains, which was, of course, was not proven by Chigger. Chigger proved a statement in Riemannian geometry about 30 years ago. Then it was extended to various setups by Alon and Milman, Lawler and Sokal, and Jerome and Sinclair, various versions. And I'm going to state the relevant definitions and maybe give you an exercise to prove it. So here's the statement. So there's two quantities that we're looking at, and they're analytical quantities. So one quantity is an L2 quantity. That's the spectral gap. So the spectral gap is defined in the following way. It's the minimum over all functions of the Dirichlet form of f with f divided by the variance of f. I'll define the Dirichlet form in a second. The variance, since I divide by the variance of f, I assume here that the variance of f is not equal to 0. So I'm not allowing looking at constant function. What's the Dirichlet form of f? The Dirichlet form of f is 1 half sum over all xy, the joint probability of x and y. So we're talking about reversible chain, so it's going to be pi x, probability of going from x to y, and then fx minus fy squared. So what does this measure? So the variance of f measures sort of the global variation of the function f. The Dirichlet form measures the local variation. What's the locality of the, what is the locality that we're looking at? We're just saying, oh, we're just looking at going to look at pairs that are close by. How are we going to make a quantitative statement about being close by? We're going to say, oh, we're going to look at x and y according to the probability that x or y comes after x in the chain. Right? So if I, in the stationarity, I'm going to be at pi x, and then I'm going to move from x to y. If it's reversible, this is also equal to pi of y, p y to x. This is because we are looking at reversible chains. We're good? Okay, so this is an L2 quantity that measures the ratio between local variation and global variation. Hopefully, you'll see more of that later this week. The second quantity that we're going to talk about is conductance. And it's going to be a similar ratio, but now we're going to look at sets. We are going to think more probabilistically. So the conductance phi, that's the conductance, is going to be defined in the following way. It's the minimum of the transition probability from S to the complement of S divided by the size of S. Pi of S is the total stationary probability of S, and the minimum here is over all sets whose measure according to the stationary measure is less than a half. What is Q? QAB is the sum over all X in A and Y in B, the probability that I'm going from X to Y. So again, we can write it as pi X, PX to Y. So what is this measuring? It is a very similar quantity, but now we are looking at sets. And we are asking for a set S, what is the chance that we're going to move to S complement divided by the size of the set, okay? So these are two quantities. One is analytical. One is more combinatorial in nature because we're optimizing over sets. And Chigger's inequality states the following. I always forgot the constant, but gamma is essentially between q and q squared. So it's between 2q and q squared over 2. Okay. Okay, so that's the statement. Phi. Thank you. So I won't prove it. If you haven't seen it before, you have two options, either to do it in the least pleasurable way, which is to read the proof, or to do it in the more pleasurable way, which is to prove it. So here's, for those of you who haven't seen it, two exercises. Exercise one, so prove the easy side. So I'll give you a hint for the easy side. The easy side is take minimizing S and let F be the indicator of the set S, or maybe the complement of the set S. Okay, so that's the easy side. And exercise two is prove the hard side. And the hard side is more related to what I want to talk about in the rest of the talk. So the hard side, so there are two things here, right? One, we have to convert a set, to a function for which there is a canonical operator that does that, right? We just look at the indicator of the set. The other direction, which is more interesting, is how do you convert a function to a set? So here's the hard side, so I'll tell you what you need to do. So for the hard side, you have a function. So you take a minimizer f. And what you should do is you should consider S of the form all of the x such that f of x is less or equal than gamma for some gamma. So this is just the levels. You choose some level, and you look at the level set corresponding to the function. So the geometric intuition here is the following. F of x sort of tells me which vectors want to be on the left, and which of the x's wants to be on the left, and which of the x's wants to be on the right. But I'm not really sure how to cut it, so I will have to consider maybe all possible gammas and choose the best gamma in order to get the set that is a good set. We're good? Anybody wants me to solve this exercise tomorrow? OK, if you want me to do it tomorrow, you can tell me tomorrow, and we'll just do one of the sides tomorrow. So I don't actually want to talk about that. What I want to talk is, OK, so why is this related to what we want to talk about? What's going on here is we want to find a partition that's a good combinatorial partition of the state space. And the way we do it is we do it in an analytical way. So we look at this variational problem, which is some L2 problem, which is the kind of problems we know how to solve in calculus using, you know, very elementary methods. And we say, well, what we're actually after is sets. So after I found this very interesting looking function, I'm going to convert it to sets, and I'm going to say that the set is not too bad. Okay? And that's the philosophy that we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about partitions of graphs that we want to do in a similar fashion. Questions? OK. So the basic question that we want to ask today, and I'm just going to talk about one model, when is partitioning according to second eigenvector a good idea? Okay, so you should ask, where is the second eigenvector expression coming from? The normalization here of looking at the Dirichlet form and the variance, both of these expressions are invariant under adding a constant. So if I add a constant to the function f, it remains the same. If I add a constant to the function f, the function remains the same. So this expression automatically mods out by the constant. And if you think about the operators that you're talking about here, the most dominant contribution is actually coming from the constant. So the constant is the largest contribution. And looking at expressions like that makes sure that we're actually looking at the second eigenvalue of the operator. That's just the Markov operator of that we're looking at here. Does that make sense? OK? OK, so I'm going to talk about a specific model. And the model is going to be the following.
That's true only if the Markov chain is reversible.
So it's true if only the Markov chain is reversible. Otherwise, if the Markov chain is not reversible, you have to do some tricks in order to apply L2 theory. So there's various tricks, like you can take, if you have the transition matrix P, you can look at P plus P transpose over 2, do the spectral analysis on this matrix and see what probabilistic information you can get from that to the Markov chain that you care about. Or you can look at P times P transpose, which is again a normal operator, and, you know, do the analysis on it and see what information can you extract on the chain that you care about. But this requires some work, right? So this is not as obvious as what we're doing here. In fact, there is a Cheeger inequality for non-reversible chains, but let's not think about it right now because you have to do this adaptation and it takes some care. Okay, so if you want to read about it, I mean, I guess Yuval's book, Yuval and David Levin's book is a good book. And Laurent Sal, of course, who was supposed to lecture, lecture notes are also very good lecture notes about that. So this could be good sources. And you can email me if you don't find these resources. OK, so the model that we're going to talk about is the following model. It's going to be a very simple model of random graphs. So it's called the block model. Well, it's going to be very simple. There's going to be n vertices on the left. There's going to be n vertices on the right here. And so here are the vertices. And the rules is the following. Left to left and right to right are both connected to each other with probability P. And left to right is connected to each other with probability Q. And not that it really matters, but I'm going to assume for simplicity that P is bigger than Q. Okay. So this is a model of random graph that by definition has two sides. There's a left side and there's a right side. And the model is defined in a way that if I draw it this way, obviously your goal is to be able to find the left side and the right side. And the question that we want to ask, in particular in the setting of what we've seen before, we can look at this graph as a matrix, maybe normalized, maybe not normalized. We can ask, what's the top eigenvector and what's the second eigenvector? And we can ask, is the second eigenvector going to give me the information about what's on the left and what's on the right? So the question is, so there are parameters p, q, and n. When, as a function of p, q, and n, second eigenvector of something, so we are actually going to talk about the second eigenvector of adjacency matrix. Gives the partition. So what is gives? Well, you may have to do something like that, right? The second eigenvector is a real valued function. You have to decide left and right, which is a discrete decision. So you'll have to make a call about what is left and what is right. Here it's very natural not to use the gamma such that there's n over 2 on the left of gamma and n over 2 of the right of gamma. That would be a very natural thing to do in this. We're good? Questions, comments? Questions, comments? Please say something. Otherwise, I feel that nothing is happening. No? Okay. Okay, so that's the question that we're going, to ask. And in fact, this question, I mean, even though I said there are no research problems, this is open. So we know a lot about it, but we actually don't know what the answer is. And you know, I'll tell you a lot of what we know, but this exactly what values of NP and Q this holds for, we don't really know. You good? Oh, very good. So what is expected? So that's, thank you for asking. You know, somebody is leading the discussion. So the first question, maybe before asking what is known, is to ask what is expected. So anybody has a suggestion to say what is expected? Or the other way of saying it, when is it clear that the second eigenvector is not going to give us anything? Right, so if we can think about what's not expected, so you can ask what is expected. Okay, so let's say some obvious things just to warm up. So what is obvious? P is Q is the same, we're dead, right? You know, there's no way we can say what's left and what's right. Okay, very good. So what's the, you know, the mathematical extension of that? P and Q are close to one another, it should also be problematic. How can we quantify what does it mean for P and Q to be close to one another? So I claim the following claim. In order to identify left and right, with high probability, that means this probability going to 1 as n goes to infinity, it's necessary that the probability that a binomial n or n minus 1 q is bigger than binomial n minus 1 p times n goes to 0. So what you said is that it's necessary that binomial n minus 1 q times is bigger than the probability that if they're equal, then this probability is 1/2, and this doesn't go to 0 because we cannot distinguish. But in fact, I claim that this can be strengthened. We actually need that n times the probability that binomial nq is bigger than binomial np has to go to 0. Why is that true? So let's write it in words, and you know, and let's formalize it little by little. If all my neighbors oh, sorry, if the majority of my neighbors are my opposites, how can you know who am I? So this is very philosophical. So let's think about what does it mean mathematically. Suppose I condition on the fact, I give you everybody in the graph, I tell you all the nodes in the graph, and I tell you which one is a plus and a minus, except some poor guy that you didn't know who that guy is. So now, if there's some chance that one guy has a majority, most of the guys have the majority of their neighbors of the same sign, or the same side, because P is bigger than Q. But if there's some unlucky guy that has more opposite neighbors, then if I give you everybody but this guy, and I say, well, I'm actually not just giving you the graph, I'm also giving you all the values of left and right, or plus and minuses, and all of the vertices, except this one guy, which, you know, I didn't ask for some reason. Now I ask you to say, okay, please tell me what this guy is. You can, you don't, you won't be able to say, because there's some chance that this guy is the opposite guy, right? In order to make this argument formal, you have to be a little bit more careful, because there's exactly n guys here and n guys here. So I have to find one guy of this type and one guy of the other type. And I ask you, oh, is it true that, you know, this guy is on the left, or is this guy is on the right, or is it the other way around? And, you know, you ask, you can't really tell. Okay? So this you can make exercise. You can make it into an argument. So exercise, make this rigorous. And one way that I suggested right now is using this majority rule and coupling between what's happening on the left and what's happening on the right. We're good?
Formally, what you mean to identify, you mean to find a strategy that guesses which on which side, with probability which tends to one?
Right, it's high probability. So high probability means that you tell me for everybody who is on the left and who is on the right, and you write for everybody with probability going to one. So the probability that you misclassify even a single person goes to zeros and goes to infinity. Thank you. Good, good question. Other questions? Okay, so that's what we want to understand. Like I said, we don't know if it can be done with the second eigenvector. Let me tell you what we do know. So I had to talk about the second eigenvector, so let's talk a little bit about some random matrix, a little bit about random matrices. So all of you have seen random matrices before. How many of you have seriously seen random matrices before? Seriously means that, you know, you actually did a computation involving random matrices. Very good. So there's something for me to tell you. Good, because all I'm going to tell you is elementary. So what's the philosophy of this kind of situation? This is not something that's particular only to this problem. The philosophy is very simple. You're looking at what you want to do is you want to do the following. You look at A, which is the adjacency matrix. And somehow what you want to understand is you want to understand it in terms of signal and noise. So what you do is you write A as the expected value of A plus A minus the expected value of A. Okay? So let's start with the expected value of A. How does the matrix, the expected value of A, looks like? It's written over there, so we know how to write it. And, you know, since we can arrange it in any way we want, we can just write it as a block matrix, which is P, 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 n times. There's a block of n by n of p's, and there's similar q's. Then there's another block of p's here. Then there's another block of q's here. And I'm cheating a little bit because I didn't say what I'm doing on the diagonal, but on the diagonal I can do whatever I want. That's always the rule, that you can do in the diagonal whatever I want. So that's what I do in the diagonal. So this matrix is very simple. In particular, we know everything about it. What's the top eigenvector and eigenvalues? Well, it's a stochastic symmetric everything matrix. So the top eigenvalue is the one vector, and the corresponding eigenvalue. So I plug in the whole one vector, I get n times p plus q. Okay, so this is non-informative. You see that it has, this eigenvector has nothing to do with the community. It has to do with something like the average degree. And the value that you get is this value. What's the second eigenvalue? What do you mean same? Okay, the philosophy of what's going on here is that the second eigenvalue should eigenvalue and second eigenvector should contain some information. So it's going to be the vector that's going to be n ones followed by n minus ones. Let's see what happens when we look at n ones followed by n minus one. Well, it's really a 2x2 matrix that's going on here. So we get n times p minus q, and similarly in the bottom. So the corresponding eigenvalue is n p minus q. Okay, so this is just basic linear algebra. We haven't done anything. Now we want to say something about the noise.
How do we know that this is a second?
Because this is a rank 2 matrix. You can, in fact, you know, you can, I mean, just looking at this matrix, you see that this is the tensor of the matrix P, Q, Q, P by a matrix that's all 1, 1, 1, 1. So you have to think about it, but, you know, in this case, it's not hard. So it's a good question, but, you know, it's kind of, you just look at it, there are only two numbers, right? So it's a rank 2 matrix, so there's only two vectors, okay? The multiplicity of this eigenvector is high, but, you know, that's the eigenvector. Okay, good. So we know that, and now we want to understand the rest. So now we look at A minus EA. So A minus EA is a random matrix. So this is a mean zero random matrix. And for such matrices, a lot is known. And I'm going to, just to make it interesting, I'm going to apply a result for this matrix that actually doesn't apply to this matrix. Okay, so there's a long line of results that deal with random matrices of this form. So it starts from the Hungarian Komlos in the 80s. And then there's a long list of people. And then the result I'm going to apply is the result of Seginer, who left academia, did a very nice PhD 20 years ago, and according to LinkedIn, now is working in software in the Netherlands. That's what I could find about it. It's a very nice result. This result says the following. So theorem, consider an n times m random matrix with IID, all entries are independent and identically distributed. Entries and everything is bounded. Consider a random matrix M with IID entries. And then we can say the following. The expected value of the top eigenvalue of M in absolute value is less or equal than some absolute constant K. So this is some constant that does not depend on anything. And then there's the expected value, let me write it this way, the maximum over all I of the norm of the vector, the ice row of the matrix. I actually don't need this, but let me write it anyway, because the result is more general. It holds for matrices that are not necessarily have the same dimension. The maximum of all the norms of the columns of the matrix. So let's, okay, so if you haven't seen random matrices, this is too fast for you, and you know we should go slowly. So first of all, let's look at this expression and see why is this interesting for us. Why is this interesting for us? Because what is the philosophy that we're following right now? The philosophy that we're following is that we want to say that there's A, which is signal, which is the expected value of A, which we understand very well. And there's noise, which is A minus the expected value of A, which we don't understand well. So we want to bound how bad can this be. How are we going to bound how bad can this be? So here, since this is the noise, we want to bound all eigenvalues of this. We want to bound the L2 no operator norm of this. So this is what we're bounding here. Why is this result nice for us? So this is what we want to bound. Why is this result nice for us? This result is nice for us because on the left-hand side, there's eigenvalue of a random matrix, which sounds like a horrible expression we don't want to deal with. On the right-hand side, we have maximum of norms of vectors. So maximum is as probabilist we understand. It means that we have to understand tail probabilities. So tail probabilities we know how to deal with. And you know, now there's a bunch of columns. All of them have the same distribution. We'll have to think about this distribution a little bit and figure out how the tails behave, and then we'll be able to bound this. Okay, good. A question for you. So I'm going to apply this theorem, but your exercise right now is to tell me why I'm not allowed to apply it. Right, so they're not IID. The matrix that we're looking at, the matrix A minus expected value of A, not of all of the entries have the same distribution. Sometimes I subtract Q, sometimes I subtract P. It's not just that. When I subtract P, you know, it's actually binomialist probability P. Otherwise, it's binomialist probability Q. It's not IID. But I'm going to ignore it and just treat it as I can use it. And then if we have time, I'll explain why are you allowed to do that. Okay, so we're going to do that. So one remark is that our M not IID, but it's okay, and if there's time, I'll tell you why. Okay, so the second question is how do you bound this quantity, the maximum of the MI star? So I claim the following. So I claim that, let's look at the expected value, say, of the rows. So what can MI star be? Most of the time, we're thinking about small p and q. So most of the time, the actual entry is 0. We have no edge in the graph. Then we're looking at 0 minus p. Okay, so that's going to be the entry. And then we take the square, so there's going to be p squared, and there's going to be at most n coordinates. So most of the time, it's going to be square root, at most square root n p plus q. Except sometimes an entry is on, and when an entry is on, it's at most one in absolute value. So let me just write it plus the expected value of the maximum over I of AI star. Okay, the entries that are small contribute at most square root n p plus q. And then there are the other entries, and the other entries, you know, we can just bound by one when they're not zero, and then we get the maximum of the AI. How large is going to be the maximum of the AI when we're looking at this model? So in expectation, it should behave like there's going to be n times p plus q ones, and all the ones are going to be 0. It's going to be somewhat concentrated. So I claim that it's at most 10 times square root n p plus q. You have to check that in this regime of the parameter that we're talking about. So there's something that's missing. But in the regime of the parameters that we're talking about, this actually holds. What is the regime of the parameters that we're talking about? So this has to hold. And actually, a corollary of that, or something that you can verify independently, is that n times p over q has to be bigger than log n. So the average degree has to be at least log n. Can anybody give me an independent reason why the average degree has to be at least log n? Somebody who knows something about random graphs? If the average degree of a random graph is log n over 2, what happens? It's disconnected. And why is it disconnected? There's an isolated vertex, right? So suppose you are the isolated vertex, and we're trying to decide if you're a plus or a minus. You know, we don't have any chance, right? Especially if there are two of you. There's one isolated vertex there, one isolated vertex there. There's no way for us to say what is plus and what is minus. So you check that if n times p plus q is bigger than log n, then in fact the concentration here is enough, and you get that this is at most 10 square root n p plus q. So then let's see what would our colleagues in the electrical engineer department conclude from that? Okay, maybe some of you are in the electrical engineer department. Some of our colleagues in the electrical engineer department, what would they conclude from the picture that we have here? So there's a picture where we have a signal and we have a noise. And what do engineers do with signals versus noise? They look at the ratio, and if the ratio is high, they're happy. Okay, so let's do that. So this is an intuition. Signal versus noise give us n times p minus q over, there's a constant which I'm not going to write, square root n p plus q, which gives us square root n p minus q over square root p plus q. Now, I claim that for this to hold, this has to go to infinity. So let's look at this condition. Let's call condition 1. And this is quantity 2, or let's call this quantity A. So the claim is, so this is again a fact about binomials. If one holds, then A goes to infinity. And this is again just a factor about the binomial, right? This is not something very mysterious. We have a guy, we look at all the neighbors of the guy. This is a binomial distribution. In the binomial distribution, we want to know we want to be sure that looking at the binomial, we know if it's a plus or a minus. So we know that the standard deviation has to be much smaller than the difference in mean. So that's what happens here. There's something to check again in the Poisson case where the degrees are relatively small, but that is actually true. So if we were engineers that are not very careful, we would say we're done. Okay, the proof is over and we're done. What is missing here? So what is missing here is that you want to make this argument more rigorous. So let's try to do that. So we want to make this a spectral argument. That is rigorous. So the spectral argument goes under different names. So it's called Davis Kahan bounds. But in our case, it's so simple that you don't need to do it. You can just do it by hand. So let's do it by hand. So we want to understand what is going on here. So let's do the following. So we're going to look at x is going to be the maximizer of x transpose ax. Among which vectors? Among the vectors with mean 0, orthogonal to the 1 vector, and L2 norm, say 1. So that's the vector that we want to use in order to partition. Okay? Now we're going to try to analyze this vector. So this vector is orthogonal to the all 1 vector, which makes us very happy, because it means that this top eigenvector and top eigenvalue are not going to be part of the game. So this is out. So how can we write this eigenvector? We can write it as y, which is this eigenvector, plus some other part. So let's do that. So x is equal to a times y plus c times z. So a squared plus c squared is 1, where y and z are orthogonal. So y is the same eigenvector that we have here. There, it's the second eigenvector. And z is orthogonal to 1 and to y. We're good? OK, so now let's look at this x and try to understand what is x transpose ax. What is x transpose ax? Well, x transpose ax is, we're going to decompose it. So it's going to be x transpose expected value of a plus a minus expected value of a times x. Now, for the expected value of A, Z doesn't matter because Z lies in the orthogonal space, so we only see the Y. So what we're going to get is we're going to get A times Y transpose expected value of A, Y. Then for the rest, we just get the X. We get X transpose A minus the expected value of AX. What is this equal to? Well, this is the same. A, sorry, plus. Is this what I wanted to do? Yeah, okay, that's what I'm going to do. So it's AY transpose EAY plus this. I know that this is most lambda 1. So it's plus, sorry, this is not exactly. This is plus minus lambda 1, whereby plus minus, I mean it's between that and minus lambda 1 and that and plus lambda 1. Okay? Because this number, the operator norm of this operator is at most lambda 1, so therefore this is at most lambda 1. So what does that mean? Let's stare at this expression for a second and try to understand what does it mean. What does it tell us about the structure of X that's the R max? So it means that A has to be very close to 1. Even if it's not exactly 1, you want to maximize this quantity. So remember, this is just A times N times P minus Q. And lambda 1 is a smaller order quantity than N times P minus Q. So, you know, even if we get a little bit of error here, we want A to be as large as possible. Okay? So the conclusion from that is that A is 1 minus little o of 1, and B is little o of 1. Question. I see some unhappy faces even among the experts, so.
C.
Say again?
Let's C, whatever. C instead of A.
C. Thanks. Yes? Other puzzlements?
Shouldn't there be A squared instead of A?
Yes. Thank you. And similarly, C squared. But yes, you are. Good. Other cheatings and typos? Okay, good. So this is sort of what the engineer said. The engineer said that, you know, we essentially have the vector y, but this essentially doesn't mean that we actually have the vector y. We have a vector that looks very close to the vector y. What's the probabilistic condition from that? So a corollary of that. If I look at the partition L hat equals all I such that yi xi is bigger than 0, and R hat equal all I such that xi is less than 0, then the distance between LR and L hat R hat is little o of n. These partitions are essentially the same up to a little o of the number of vertices. One question you should have all asked me: we cannot really distinguish between left, right, and right, left, right? So this is unordered partition. We don't know what is the left and what is the right. But other than that, this is what this argument shows. The vector is very close to y. X is very close to, let's repeat the argument. The vector x, according to this argument, is very close to y in L2. The vector, right, so what am I cheating at? The vector y is actually a vector that's all 1 or plus minus 1. So it's, there's no issues about being huge coordinates that control all of the mass. The vector is just a 1 minus 1 vector. So whenever you're different in sign, you have to be different by at least 1. So you have to be different by a lot. You cannot be different by a lot in a lot of coordinates. So if you decide according to the thresholding rule, you are going to get most of the partition correctly. We're good?
But you want to get all the partition.
But I want to get all the partition. I said this is still open. I mean, if we would solve it during the class when I'm doing all these bugs and sheets, that would be amazing. So what is still open? Open, it may be the case. Maybe open. Maybe with high probability, L hat, R hat, equal to L R. We don't know that, right? This has to do with a more detailed structure of the eigenvector, right? It's not just that most of the coordinates are right. The eigenvector is an eigenvector. So I'm at a node, I'm the average of all my neighbors multiplied by this P minus Q. So there's some additional information there. Errors just cannot pop up wherever we want, right? But that's you need to analyze more carefully, and we don't know how to do that. Okay, so that's an open problem for you. If anybody solves it during the conference, that would be good to know. Let me tell you what is known. So in the last 10 minutes, I'll let you what is known. I won't have any time to prove it, obviously. So theorem.
You can use the upper board if you want.
Oh, I can use that. Excellent, thank you. So theorem, under condition 1, can recover L and R exactly. Okay. Not using the eigenvector, or not just using the eigenvector. There is a way of using the eigenvector and some additional step in order to recover L and R exactly. This is a recent theorem. So this is a joint work with Niemann and Sly. And there's independent proof of something a little weaker by Emmanuel Abbe and Condon from Princeton. So there are two independent proofs of this fact. You can do, you can recover LR exactly. So I'll entertain you in the last 5 or 10 minutes in telling you how to do that. But you know, this is something that you know won't have too much to do with the rest of what we're talking about. So how do you do that? So it's done in 3 steps. So the first step is just what we did. So you find x and corresponding partition. Okay, so we do use this argument to find most of the guys, and we know that most of them are correct. We don't know who is correct and not who is not correct. Step 2 is something that's coming sort of from a different world, but I'll just tell you what the basic idea is. This is what is called the replica trick. It's related to ideas of replica from physics. And the replica trick is the following. What you do is you actually don't do what I just told you. Instead, you take random delta n vertices away, and you're going to run step 1 here. I'm going to run step 1 here. I'm going to get most of these guys correctly. But I don't know. I'm actually not interested in these guys. I'm interested in these guys. How am I going to find these guys? For each of these guys here, I'm going to look at all of its neighbors over there. And I'm going to take the majority of all of the neighbors. And that's going to be the label of that sign. So let's write it formally. So take or partition. Take a random partition to sets of size delta n. So the sets may be AI. For each A is a bad name, SI. For each SI, run step 1 on everybody on all the vertices minus si. And then for each j in si, let the sine of j be the majority of the sine of k, where k is a neighbor of j, and k is in v minus si. So what does this buy me? This buy me independence. When I remove that, you have to think about it a little bit, but that's the idea of the replica trick. When I remove this piece of the graph, what I have on the remainder of the graph is sort of the same model on the remaining vertices. Since what I have is a remaining model on the same vertices, now I have some a big fraction of the vertices that are correct. The connection between this guy and the other guys is independent. It doesn't depend on what my first step did. It's independent. So for each guy here, I get each guy correct with some probability, and each guy not correct with some other probability. This is independent. I can use concentration of measure. Okay, so that's what you use here. Formally, what happens is, you know, you look at V epsilon, which are all the nodes X, X has majority greater than square root or epsilon square root n log n times p. So these are nodes that originally had a big majority. They weren't very close to 1/2, 1/2. And you show that all the Vs vectors in all the nodes in V epsilon are going to be classified correctly. So the claim is that nodes in V epsilon are classified correctly. Okay, so this is story. This is the story. I'm sorry, it's very quick. Let me just summarize what happens at each of the steps. So at this step, you get 1 minus little of 1 of the nodes correct. So I gave it at a lecture where there was a very, very rich person present. And I explained that this algorithm is all about how to get from the 99% to the rest of the people. And he wasn't very happy about that, right? So you start from the 99%. Here in this step, you don't quite get everybody, because there are going to be a few guys that are going to be very, very close together. They are going to be almost 1/2, 1/2. So here you get something like 1 minus, you get n minus n to the maybe 1/4 of the nodes correctly. So there's going to be n to the 1/4 of the nodes that are still going to be incorrect. And then what you're going to do then? I got almost everybody correctly. There's just like n to the 1/4 nodes that are not correct. Or, you know, you choose the power. What do you do then? You do the only thing you can do. Then you take another majority step. Then you look at the whole graph. For each node, you take the majority of their neighbors, and you're going to say that's going to be the color of this guy, and that's going to be the end. What do you need for the analysis of the last step? For the analysis of the last step, you need something like arguing it's not very likely that two bad guys are going to be close to each other, are going to participate in the same bad action. Or in the case where the graph is denser, you have to argue that the margin is not very close to 1/2, 1/2. And that's how you prove this claim. So one of the reasons I told you this story is that this proof is quite involved. It would be much nicer if you can prove that just using this finds the partition, right? So it's a nice open problem, and I think it's sort of related to Chigger's inequality. What I'm going to talk about tomorrow is I'm going to talk about the case of sparse graphs. I mean, here we need the graphs to be connected. Tomorrow we're going to talk about the case where the graph is not even necessarily connected. And then all of these spectral methods break up completely. And then we're going to see more speculative stuff. Some of it is known by now. Things that have to do with semi-definite programs or Grothendieck inequality and non-backtracking random walks. And you know, there's going to be a more speculative picture about what's going on there. OK, so I'll stop here, and I'll see you tomorrow. And if you have questions, please ask.